Have you got any favourite Ashes memories? Obviously, you probably had a few bad ones over the few years, but there must have been some great ones.
The favourite Ashes, there's a couple. We won at Edgbaston in, you'd have to tell me the year, 97. Yeah. We won the opening test match to go 1-up. So that was a huge highlight for me, because then the hope and the dream that I'd have had as a schoolboy was still alive, but it soon got killed. But that was a big moment. And a win in Melbourne in the 98-99 series. So I scored 100 in the test match, but we won a fantastic game. That last session on day four went on for about 3.5-4 hours. Rampakash caught that great catch to get rid of Justin Langer. And then Dean Headley went on and got really at 6 or 7 for, I think. Those are the two standouts. But I say, unfortunately, I played in an era when they were very much the best side in the world and had the better of us.
But those are those moments. Those two tests are fine examples of those moments that I suppose any England player or fan, when they go into a series, those are what they remember. And then when they think that's how they want England to play, isn't it? That's what they want from their side.
Yeah, it is. You know, as I say, because Australia set a benchmark, you know, from the late 80s into the early 90s, right the way through to around about this period, they've dominated the world game. But no, if you get a chance to turn over the big boys, then take every opportunity.
Now, obviously, two changing sides from the last series. Do you think that they're both shaping up quite well? Both sort of perhaps going to hit their straps with some of the young players coming through this summer?
Yeah, I see it. To be honest, I see it as pretty evenly matched, talent for talent. You know, I don't see one side much better than the other. You could say, you know, Ricky Ponting will get into any World 11. Well, I'll say Kevin Peterson will. You know, they've got Philip Hughes, who everyone is talking about, saying he's a new wonder kid on the block. Well, I'll throw in the name Alistair Cook and Ravi Bapara. You know, so I think they match up. There's talk about the spin department. You know, they've got a bloke, Nathan Horitz, who I played against, who is average. You know, so I think Graham Swan, Monty Panesar, Adil Rashid will out-bowl Nathan Horitz. So, you know, I think it'll be closely matched. You know, I keep saying that I'm back in England to win it, because I seriously believe that. It's not just my heart ruling my head. I seriously think that we'll nick the series.
You mentioned the spin aspect of it. Do you think there's a potential of Rashid coming through as well, perhaps a spin duo? He looks as if he might have got ahead of Panesar recently. Do you see those two perhaps bowling in tandem at some point?
Yeah, I mean, there's all talk that Cardiff, the opening test match, is going to favour two spinners. Swan is a number one spinner, and I think he's done exceptionally well over the last 9 or 12 months. So he deserves and warrants the place if there's just one spinner. If you pick the second one, Panesar has been there and done it. He's had a slow, sluggish start this summer. Adil Rashid, new kid on the block, I thought performed nicely in the World 2020. Completely different, but he didn't look fazed by the big stage. So he's certainly put his name in the ring. Will he do it? Possibly, because of his all-round game. You know, and he's something different. The Australians have seen Panesar, a leg spinner. He may not be as consistent as Panesar, but he's something different who can just turn a game. So, to answer your question, I think he will feature.
Well, it'll be exciting to obviously see, perhaps even, as we've mentioned, two spinners in tandem. How does this series, 2009, how does that match up? How is that going to compete with the last series here in England, which was, as many people acknowledge, one of the best series we've seen here? Can it get close to that?
I'd be surprised, because as I say, that will probably be the best series of my time. Just for the quality of the cricket, the style of the cricket, and the spirit that the cricket was played in. I'd say it won't match 2005. But I'm also big on not harping back to 2005, because that's been and gone. And very few of the players who played in that series will be playing in the 2009 series. So, yeah, have that in the memory banks. But I'd much rather look forward, much rather lads think we can create our own little bit of history if we win this series. And that's how they've got to think, you know. And they'll probably walk out and there'll be the video being played on a big screen there of Vaughan and Freddie and KP and whatever winning those Ashes in 2005. But unfortunately, we've got to remember, since then, we got whitewashed 5-0 down in Australia. So that's what I say, look forward, don't look back.
And just finally then, I suppose, the interesting question, key men on either side, there's the obvious, you mentioned Ponting and Peterson, people like that, but perhaps there are any players that you feel that might come through and really change or swing the series in their team's direction?
Well, as I say, the two younger players, you know, Bapara and Hughes, one on each side, are two very exciting prospects. You know, Ravi Bapara has surprised, when I say surprised me, I knew he was a big talent, but he surprised me how well he's done at number three. I thought he'd be more of a number five, but he's nailed in that number three at the moment. He looks very good. Well, I've seen a Phil Hughes, not a classical batsman, but it looks a very effective batsman. I just hope we've worked out plans how to get him out. And then Mitchell Johnson, from an Australian point of view, I see is a very, very special cricketer. You know, he can bowl with good pace, and he also can hit a long ball with a bat in his hand. So he will play a part. And from an England point of view, I just think Anderson is going from strength to strength. He really has grown up and grown into now a leading international world-class bowler.
Do you think he can drag this sort of bowling attack through and really impose themselves on the Australian lineup?
Yeah, exactly. You know, I'm now harping back to 2005, but you know, the four-pronged pace attack there did a great job, worked nicely as a team and as a group. This group of bowlers is good. And there's more strength and depth in this group of bowlers as well. You know, if you look at, well, you're going to say Broad and Anderson nailed on certainties. Then you're going to say Flintoff, if he's fit, is going to play. Then you've got Sidebottom, Onions. I'm going to throw in Harmison because I'm a big fan of his. I seriously believe that he's got a part to play. It's nice to see he's taking wickets for Durham now. There'll be other people who are saying, pick me.
And that's the exciting thing, I suppose.
Well, what you want the selectors to be able to pick from a big squad, you know, and have tough decisions. Who are we going to leave out, not who do we have to pick? You know, I played in sides when eight people are good enough to play international cricket, and then it's, well, we've got to play 11. Who can we find? You know, whereas now, you know, the depth in strength is there, or strength in depth, I should say, and then it's up to them who they select.